So, welcome friends and seniors, Dr. Vishali, Dr. Diksha, PKB, Shishir, and Sangeet. I think Dr. Dinesh Talwar will join us soon. So, I'll start sharing my screen and we'll start with our session right away. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
So,
Dinesh, you start. We are ready.
Just a moment. So our instruction course number 10 is about the relevance of fundus fluorescein angiography and indocyanine green angiography in ophthalmic practice. And I'll introduce the both modalities, diagnostic modalities, which are very important for vitreoretina practice. However, nowadays, because these are a bit invasive procedures, so there is some hesitancy, especially in the newcomers, to order these investigations, which form a major role in the diagnosis and management of the disorders. Initially, we might need these investigations, but for follow-up, of course, we can do non-invasive techniques. So this instruction course has been designed in such a way that we can go through the procedures of fundus fluorescein angiography as well as ICG and the newer developments like ultra wide field angiography along with the dye-less angiography, and the special feature this year is the pediatric fluorescein angiography, which is again very important in certain situations. So I welcome all the participants to the session, and they will be the panelists for the discussion in this session. So I have no financial disclosures to make. This is how the instruction course will go. Introduction, then indications, then when to repeat, then ICG indications, ultra wide field angiography, dye-less angiography, and pediatric angiography. So fundus fluorescein angiography has been there for almost 60 years now in clinical use. The basic principle is that the fluorescein angiography, there is a visualization of the fluorescein dye in the intravascular and extracellular spaces. Fluorescein is an orange-red crystalline hydrocarbon. It's a C20, low molecular weight and high solubility in water, which allows it a rapid diffusion, and it is available in the strengths of 5%, 10%, and 20% solution. 80% of the fluorescein gets bound to the serum protein, and 20% is an unbound fluorescein, which gives us the interpretation which we need at the level of the retina. This is the only tissue in the body where we are able to see bare vessels, and the inner and outer blood retinal barriers, they are impermeable to fluorescein, whereas choriocapillaries are freely permeable to fluorescein. Sodium fluorescein gets excited at a light energy between 465 to 490 nanometer, that is the blue spectrum. So we need a blue filter, and the fluorescence wavelength is 520 to 530, which is the green yellow. So there are various indications which Dr. Sangeet will take care and discuss individually, starting from diabetic retinopathy, vascular occlusions onto ocular tumors. Basically, we need to instruct the patient to be empty stomach for at least 3 hours before the procedures. Then we dilate both the pupils with the dilatation drops. The procedure itself takes about 15 minutes, and nowadays, there are digital cameras, so the reporting can be done immediately. There is yellow discoloration of the skin. The vision is blurred for a few hours. The patient passes green colored or a dark red colored urine for a day. And these are the things which we need to tell the patient beforehand. However, he needs to report if there is any allergy in the form of rash or itching or something like that. And because it is an invasive procedure and there can be some complications or anaphylaxis associated with the procedure, informed consent for pseudotumor fluorescein angiography is must. And this is the typical consent which we normally take. Arm to choroid time is about 10 to 15 seconds. Complete choroid filling takes another 3 to 5 seconds, and the arteriovenous transit time is 8 to 12 seconds. So in about half a minute or 30 seconds, the most of the procedure is over. And after that, we just take the recirculation phase and the late phase. So these are the different phases. So there is a choroidal phase when the choroidal filling starts to occur. Then the arterial phase, then the early arteriovenous phase when there is a laminar flow, then the late arteriovenous phase, then recirculation phase, which is after that half minute, and late phase photographs are taken at about 5 to 10 minutes. So there can be externalization of this dye into the local tissues. So one has to be careful while injecting the dye. And there can be nausea, vomiting, or vasovagal shock immediately on injecting the bolus, or there can be antihistaminic. There can be allergic reactions, so you need antihistaminics. There can be anaphylaxis, hypotension, tachycardia, bronchospasm, tonic-clonic seizures, thrombophlebitis at the site of the injection. It is not absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy, but it is better to avoid in the first trimester. So emergency kit is a must. Nowadays, we keep a crash cart with all the antihistaminics and steroids, as well as the resuscitation equipment along with. So there can be blocked hypofluorescence, filling defects, pseudo-fluorescence, hyperfluorescence, or a delayed hypofluorescence. These are the patterns which are seen on fluorescein angiography due to the various defects or diseases. And one may see blocked fluorescence because of a choroidal nevus or any branch vein occlusion or a preretinal hemorrhage. The hemorrhage will block the fluorescence and the dye will not be seen in those areas. There can be hypofluorescence because of filling defect because of a optic nerve pit, choroideremia, macular scar, or a BRVO with the NVE. Then pseudofluorescence might be seen in rib, and hyperfluorescence is usually seen in a neovascular condition or in large macroaneurysms, dilated leaking vessels, even malignant melanoma or a cystoid macular edema will also give a hyperfluorescence. Then RP tear, CSR also gives hyperfluorescence, and telangiectatic vessels will also hyperfluoresce during angiography. Between angiography, fundus fluorescein angiography and ICG, there are certain limitations of FA, like masking of choroidal fluorescence by ocular pigments and rapid leakage into the choroid capillaries, which masks the choroidal vasculature. So ICG gives better visualization in those situations and is important for choroidal studies. And you need infrared filter in the camera for that. It is a water-soluble dye, and it is comparatively safer, and it is reconstituted in the aqueous solution. It is comparatively safer to sodium fluorescein. However, adverse reactions can occur. It's an iodine dye, so there are, if there is any allergy to iodine, that then this should be avoided. So IC as a whole will be taken care by Dr. Dinesh Talwar. And there are special indications for this. It allows you various layers of the choroid to be seen separately, the Heller's layer, Stellar's layer, and a chorioperitonitis. There is a early phase, mid phase, late mid phase, and the late phase. Indications are mostly the choroidal lesions, CNVMs, and to differentiate occult and classic CNVM lesions, to look for a hot spot. So angiography, especially after the treatments have become available, ICG is very important for choroidal studies, CNVM, hotspot. So I would conclude here, and rest of these things like OCT, NGO, wide field, and other things will be taken care by the subsequent speakers. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
I think you can invite next speaker.
Yeah, if there are no comments, then I think we can go on to the next talk by Dr. Sangeet Mittal, which is on specific indications of fundus fluorescein angiography.
Thank you, Dr. Dinesh, for giving me the opportunity to present here. And though fluorescein angiography is now almost 60 years old, first being done in 1961, when this fluorescein dye was used to study the vascularity of the retina. The word specific that has come into the topic means that there is some problem with fluorescein angiography now, and it has got limitations. The most common limitation is the fear of injection to the patient. The patient lands up sometimes with almost 10% patients complain of nausea or vomiting while we do the procedure, or there's an allergy to the dye, which may even go in, though rare, but into anaphylaxis. And another cause is because of the advent of OCT angiography, the indications of FFA are decreasing day by day. OCT angiography definitely gives many advantages over FFA, like it's a three-dimensional, it's a static and better for research. But most common is, the most important advantage is that it is totally non-invasive, and it has got no side effects, no fear of injection. But OCT angiography also has its limitations. It can pick only blood flow. So vascular lesions which don't have blood flow, like microaneurysms, are not picked, and it is not dynamic, so leakage, pooling, and staining characteristics of the lesion are missed. Again, a small examination window of 10 to 12 millimeters only, and so they were studying whole or even a small part of retina is very cumbersome, and it's very difficult to use in uncooperative patients or in patients who are unable to fixate properly. The procedure that we are following generally nowadays in our hospital is an oral fluorescein angiography, which was also being reported quite early as 1979 and has shown to give us good quality images with the recent cameras that have been introduced into the market, though I have no financial interest in this. And we have done this type of oral fluorescein angiography in many patients. So what you do is you give the oral dye 25 milligrams per kilogram body weight. This dye is dissolved in 30 milliliter of sugar-free juice, which is followed by another 30 milliliter of juice without the dye. And then angiograms are taken at regular intervals. It has also got its own limitations, but this is another option that some people can follow that. So going on to the specific indications, so starting with the optic disc, FFA has no role in the diagnosis and management of pseudopapilledema or true papilledema. It has got no role in the diagnosis and management of optic atrophy. So there is no need to do FFA in these conditions, but it may sometimes differentiate between disc collaterals and disc neovascularization in doubtful cases. And sometimes it's valuable in the diagnosis and assessment of disc abnormalities and disc tumors. So this is a, you know, this is a, just pictures to show the difference, like the the disc collaterals, they won't leak. They're, the margins will be quite easily visible, but in disc neovascularization, they generally leak. The margins are fuzzy. And with the dynamic angiography, you can see that the leakage increases with time. And this is another case of disc angioma, which was diagnosed, which was differentiated into a disc angioma by using fluorescein angiography, which showed fast entry of dye into the lesion and then fast emptying of the lesion also. Again, another specific indications, the most commonly used indications include in the retinal vascular disease, where we study analytically the retinal circulation, and it may detect vascular abnormalities like infarction, capillary closure, edema, and new vessel formation. And especially in the management of diabetic retinopathy, especially if it is a recurrent disease, FFA is indicated. Also for study of the peripheral retinal vascular disease, peripheral ischemia, you need to have a FFA, the OCT angiography won't give you that picture. So these are just a few pictures. If you plan to do laser for a diabetic macular edema, you need to differentiate whether it's a focal macular edema or a diffuse macular edema. And for this, you have to do a fluorescein angiography. You with fluorescein angiography, you can pick up microaneurysms and which tend to leak in the later phases. And in diffuse macular edema, you'll see a large area of leakage from the capillary bed itself. And here you do a grid laser instead of doing a focal laser. Again, you can make out ischemic macula, though you can do it with the OCT angiography also, but with FFA, all, you get a clearer picture of an ischemic macula present, and you can prognosticate the management of these type of cases. Again, capillary non-perfusion, if it is there, you have to sometimes do a PRP, even in an early cases, if there is an extensive capillary non-perfusion. In this case, this was a PDR with a large area of capillary non-perfusion. You can go ahead without even the FFA also, but in this case, it was a case of a severe NPDR with, again, with a large area of non-perfusion, capillary non-perfusion, and you may plan to do a pan-retinal photocoagulation in this patient to prevent it from going into a worse disease. Again, to pick up subtle neovascularization, this, if you see this patient in the fundus picture, hardly you can see the new vessels, but when you do a FFA, you pick up much more new vessels. And again, for subtle NVDs, in this case, a small NVD can be picked up. And in this case, again, a very subtle NVD, though it was a large NVD, could be picked up by the OCT angiography. But on seeing the fundus, we were not able to pick up the true extent of the NVD which was there. Again, for wide field angiography, you can do with the fluorescein angiographies. And one important indication these days in the doing FFA in diabetic retinopathy is a recurrent disease. And you can, if the disease is again recurring and recurring, you can pick up peripheral lesions. You can pick up peripheral ischemia and do laser. Even for diabetic macular edema, if some people have suggested, like, you can do a peripheral laser to non-perfused retina in cases of retinal recurrent macular edema. Again, in vascular occlusions, CRVO, you can differentiate between ischemic and non-ischemic, like in these patients. The right eye, on the left side, it's a non-ischemic CRVO, and on the right side, it's a non-ischemic CRVO. Though you can make it out to some extent on seeing the fundus picture also, but you get a true picture when you do a fundus fluorescein angiography. Again, in the BRVO, you can get the right amount of non-perfusion. In this patient, there was no non-perfusion, so you don't need to do anything. Just observe this patient. But if it is a poor perfusion, you may tend to do a scatter laser, a sectoral scatter laser here. Again, for new picking up new vessels, settle new vessels, you can do a fluorescein angiography in branch retinal vein occlusions. For macular BRVO, if you plan to do a grid laser, you can pick up the area of ischemia by doing a fluorescein angiography and do a laser in that area. The pediatric indications, I think Dr. Diksha is going to cover this topic in detail, but there are some specific indications where you do a FFA, like in vasculopathies, in Coats disease, in Leber's, aneurysms in Irwan, in Fever. I'll skip this. Dr. Diksha will take over this, but you can pick up peripheral ischemia or the leaking aneurysms in these cases. Now coming to the macular disease, I think OCT angiography has taken over the management of macular disease from fundus fluorescein angiography. I think, but in some cases, like in central serous choroidectomy, a dynamic angiography is important to pick out the hotspots. For management of CNVM, I think OCTA is now more useful. For CME and for JFT, again, I think OCTA has now replaced the fluorescein angiography as such. So in CSR, you can see a smokestack appearance. You can see in the early phases, there will be a pinpoint leak, which may give you which may increase with time in size as well as in intensity. And you can have either a smokestack pattern or you can have a ink blot pattern of leakage in central serous choroidectomy. Again, another patient with a smokestack pattern. This time, the dye is coming down. This we call a downward smokestack pattern. For CNVM, as I told you, now the OCT angiography gives you better information in managing CNVM patients. But again, if you don't have an access to a OCT angiography, you can do a fluorescein angiography. That will give you idea of a classic or a non-classic CNVM as such. For a wrap lesions also can be picked up if you do a fluorescein angiography. Again, a classic and a non-classic can be differentiated. For macroaneurysms, you can pick up macroaneurysms if the hemorrhage is too big. You can macroaneurysm usually shines through. I think it will be covered later by another speakers, but you need to do a dynamic angiography in uveitis patients. So FFA becomes more important rather than OCTA here in managing these patients. Again, for ocular tumors, it differentiates between various tumors like choroidal melanomas, hemangiomas, metastatic carcinomas, and angiomatosis retinae, because more than the angiographic features, it is the rate of flow of dye into the tumors which give you a better information and better differentiation between the different tumors. Like in choroidal melanoma, you may see early double circulation, and which may later and show later staining. Choroidal hemangioma gives you a patchy hyperfluorescence, which again may increase in later phases. Metastasis give you hyperfluorescence in the later phases. It will give you hypofluorescence earlier. And again, in specific indications, like in the presence of media opacities, like asteroid hyalosis, where you can't see the retina, you can again do a fluorescein angiography and get a clearer picture of what is happening below. Thank you. Thanks for, again, I thank Dr. Dinesh for giving me this opportunity to present. Thank you. So you are, please unmute yourself.
Dinesh, we can't hear you.
Dr. Dinesh, please unmute yourself.
Sir, thank you, Dr. Sangeet, for an elaborate talk. Should we keep the discussion after all the angiography topics are covered? I think that will be better.
Yeah, I think so.
Welcome, Dr. Dinesh Talwar, sir.
Thank you. Hi. Sorry, I got a little late.
No, that's fine, sir.
Dr. Dinesh,
so we'll go ahead.
Dr. Dinesh Talwar's birthday also. Happy birthday, sir.
Oh, congratulations, sir. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Oh, happy birthday, Dr. Dinesh.
Thank you.
You got to treat us.
Yeah, let's change from Zoom to physical.
So we'll keep the discussion after all the FFA topics have been covered. So we'll go on to the next topic by Dr. Prashant Bhavankulle of Sarakshi Netralya, Nagpur. When and why should I repeat FFA or ICG? Dr. Prashant Bhavankulle, please.
Is my screen visible, Dinesh?
Yes, please. Yes.
Thank you, Dinesh. In fact, you have given me a challenging topic in the era where people are shying away from fluorescein angiography and ICG angiography, labeling it at, as invasive procedure. Let me do justice to this topic. Not only you need to repeat, see it as a primary procedure, but also repeat as and when necessary, where you can get additional information. So let's go through this program. So when do I need to repeat this? We need to understand, we need to repeat if the patient comes to you with an images previously done elsewhere, which are not of a good quality, or if the patient comes to you with a delay in initiating treatment after the previous angiogram. It also helps you, repeat angiograms helps you in monitoring the treatment response as well as disease progression. Sometimes you suspect a change in diagnosis, and in rare cases like asteroid, this is the only way to follow up the deterioration or the worsening of the disease. Well, you can repeat it as early as 3 days considering the washout point, but for disease progression and management treatment response, preferably to repeat only after 3 months. Now, all the indications which Dr. Sangeet has already alluded to stand true for repeat angiograms. Let's move to the examples now to understand. This is a 48-year-old male who had a central retinal vein occlusion with a significant macula at presentation. And he underwent naturally at that point of time angiogram, and the angiogram showed blocked fluorescence with macular edema. Patient received anti-VEGF. Now 3 months later, if you can see, he had increased edema, naturally lost vision, hemorrhages had clear, but the vision was deteriorating. We did repeat an angiogram at this point of time. And what we see on an angiogram is a NVD with severe CNP with macular edema. So it changed our treatment. Now we needed to put lasers along as well. This is case number one. Now the next case, another case of CRVO with macular edema. You can see because of great dense cataract, you can't visualize. You had a dry macula, patient was conservatively managed, and he underwent FFA at presentation. Well, we didn't have dropout areas, and so conservatively managed. At 6 months, again, he had further decreased vision, again an atrophic macula, angio. We tried to analyze if there is any ischemic area through the dense cataract. We didn't get any CNP areas. And so he was asked for a follow-up. Meanwhile, patient undergoes cataract surgery elsewhere for the same. And this is what he presents to us 3 years later. You can see on an angiogram, multiple fibrovascular proliferation all across. And naturally, an extrafoveal TRD on OCT. We advised FFA, and now you know you need, this patient needs an aggressive PRP. That is how subsequent angios helped us in watching this particular disease. Another case of vascular retinopathy, ischemic CRVO with macular edema. He underwent FFA, he had a blocked fluorescence. He underwent PRP along with anti-VEGF. 6 months later, patient presents with this neovascular glaucoma. He was given medical management. His pressures were brought down, media cleared. And this is the picture. We did an angiogram. Well, you can see skip areas as well as the dropouts. And patient underwent, again, aggressive PRP along with anti-VEGF injection. Now coming to Eales disease. This is a patient who had undergone PRP for Eales disease elsewhere along with angiogram. Now he presents to us with this particular picture with blurred vision. We did an angiogram and we could see scattered laser marks with CNP areas in periphery with NVE. Well, the angiograms are not that focused and we advised fill-in laser. Now, 9 years later, this patient presents to us again with floaters and this is the picture. Now we have suggested him FFA. We wanted to now delineate whether the bleed is because of any avulsion of a vessel induced by PVD or are there any active vessels within this so obviously looking fibrous tissue. So this is how we do it in case of Eales disease. Now coming to cases of diabetic retinopathy, 54 years female, diabetic 15 years, you see the fundus and you can see NPDR with CSME. We did an angiogram and angiogram showed a bit of macular edema And so we did focal laser with anti-VEGF at this point of time. Now, a year later, the patient presents to us with, again, decreased vision. We thought there are IRMAs or query envy in left eye. We did an angiogram and we could see the significant difference in the left eye evolution of the disease. And we advised him PRP in left eye as well. Another diabetic patient who was treated with PRP in both eyes elsewhere, and he was complaining of poor vision in spite of clinically adequately treated retinopathy. When we did an angiogram, we could see an ischemic maculopathy with two neovascular polyps in a clinically silent proliferative well-treated diabetic retinopathy, while left eye was normal. Naturally, patient received PRP in right eye to prevent further bleeds and after explaining the visual prognosis because of ischemic macula. Another diabetic patient who was advised fill in PRP in left eye only. And this was the picture. When we saw white fundus photograph, we could see some fibrous tissue. We did an angiogram to assess the situation in the right eye. Naturally, left eye had multiple polyps as expected. But see, in right eye also, we could see identify multiple NVs warranting treatment even in the silent looking right eye. And this is how FFA, repeat FFA helps you. Now, this is a patient with one-eyed patient, diabetic, and he had decreased vision. Dense asteroid, we did not have any view of fundus. We did an angiogram to understand what is happening. Well, at that time, his fundus was okay. But 6 months later, when the patient presents with further decreased vision, we had to repeat an FFA, and you can see the change in the picture. Now, coming to AMD cases and PCV, 59 years old female, multiple cystic swelling at the left eye, multiple PEDs. We did an angiogram. We saw some pooling of the dye and leak over there. We treated with anti-VEGFs, aflibercept. She responded. Vision came to 6.9. 7 weeks later, again, there is a decreased vision. We repeated an FFA as well as ICG. We could see some leaks again. And ICG, we saw a polyp. Now it modified our treatment. We decided to do it, combine the anti-VEGFs with PDT. Another case. 42 years female who had undergone focal laser for CSR elsewhere. And on an OCT, we thought we are seeing some RP rip and a PED. So we decided to do an angiogram. And as you can see, leak right in the FZ, it changed our diagnosis to CNVM. And now this patient, instead of CSR, was treated as a case of CNVM. Another case of CSR, 32 years female who complained of blurred vision in right eye. She had cystic swelling in the right eye. Angio showed a significant fluid, SRD. FFA at presentation showed 3 leaks. So we treated conservatively. Look at the left eye FFA at this point of time. It was normal. 3 weeks later, she complained of decreased vision in left eye. And you can see even the cystic swelling, even the left eye. And fluid on OCT. We had to do repeat FFA within 3 weeks. And you can see the leaks now in the left eye. So this is how a CSR varying pictures, you can need multiple FFAs. While this is a 75 years diabetic patient who had undergone IOL 1.5 months back, now complained of decreased vision. He had CME. We did an FFA, classic petaloid pattern, injection orocort given a month later, retina was flat. 10 months later, now he again complains of decreased vision. Again, he had CME. We did FFA because we thought we are seeing some microvascular abnormalities in the periphery. Yes, besides petaloid CME, we could see some microvascular abnormalities. So we decided to do a PRP along with orocort. Coming to few uvea cases, this is a patient who presented old case of GH peripheral peripapillary choroiditis, complained of decreased vision. Clinically, he looked normal. We did an angiogram and we could see a leak at the edge. So we treated him with steroids. Now, 1.5 years later, again, he complained of decreased vision. We were not sure what is happening. So we could see the leak at the edge. Another case of uveitis. Well, this patient presented with CME bilaterally with a dense cataract. He underwent FFA. Both eyes had a petaloid pattern. We treated him with injection orocort after systemic investigation, and he responded. After 6 years, this is the presentation with old KPs. FFA showed edema, and we thought we are seeing some fibrous tissue over here. We repeated an angiogram, and as expected, we could see some fibrovascular tissue, neovascularization in the left eye. So naturally, besides steroids, he needed lasers. This patient was treated on steroids after COVID treatment. We thought there are some significant pillar like on OCTs. We did an angiogram for this patient. And as you can see, when we color photo, you can see multiple tubercles at the choroidal level on high magnification. Disc was hyperemic on the left side. You see the OCT, FFA ICG was done, and you can see on an ICG hypolucent spots. Patient was confirmed, Montaux was 48 millimeter positive, patient was put on AKT. This is how the FFA was done. Yeah. This is last but one case, 25 years old female, diagnosed as Eales disease elsewhere and was advised vitreous surgery in right eye. Left eye, FFA showed normal elsewhere. Fundus at presentation, this is combined vascular retinal detachment. Left eye, we thought we are seeing some microvascular abnormalities here. We did an angiogram, and what we see is a case of severe proliferation, confirmed it as a Takayasu's disease. So this patient first needed treatment in the left eye to prevent the fate, like right eye. We treated, and then it was possible. The last case, this young female had a history of vitreous surgery elsewhere for some vascular tumor. Father as well as grandfather had history of brain surgery for some tumors. This is the picture when she came to us. We were not sure what is happening. We wanted to be doubly sure because of the significant family history. We did an angiogram, and look, to our surprise, we could see multiple angiomas in the periphery on a white field angiogram. So this patient received laser along with triple phase cryotherapy. We decided to screen her father. Father asymptomatic again, clinically fundus normal. Angiogram show multiple angiomas, again treated with lasers and cryo. We saw, decided to screen brother. Well, we saw an angioma in right eye and in left eye. Yes, and an angiogram showed multiple angiomas even in further. Yeah, this is the last case. So laser was treated, and 1 year later. So this is the pedigree charting. This is what we got. This gene was positive. And so to conclude, in such cases where clinically you cannot see an angiogram, you need to repeat yearly FFA, and that is should be the part of protocol. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. I think you have done full justice to the topic. Such an elaborate talk with the multiple long-term follow-ups. Just a quick question or a comment. Ma'am, Dr. Vishali, what are your indications for FFA and a repeat FFA, if I would request you to elaborate?
I think in today's time. I think Prashant has already highlighted it beautifully, showing by the cases. I would do repeat FFA mostly with ICG, because many a times in the first go, we generally do not do ICG. But when the disease pattern changes, like he showed a beautiful case of tubercular granulomas, which to me again could be VKH, RTV granulomas. And then there is a component where there is a serous detachment, which was not there before. So these are the kind of the cases where I'm in dilemma, whether it is VKH, CSR or something. Even if the previous has been done, I would go for repeat fluorescein ICG. So that would be the case for me.
I think I'll make a small point here. Wherever you cannot explain the story of the patient.
Absolutely.
With your OCT. You do the fluorescein angiography. So every patient is a story. You have to explain the findings. You have to explain his vision. You have to explain his symptoms. If you cannot explain them based on whatever you have on the city and clinical examination doesn't explain that, then you need to do a fluorescein angiography.
Exactly.
So both these investigations, fluorescein and ICG angiography, they are important part of retina practice, sir. I think they are going a little out of favor because of the invasive nature of the disease, investigations. So I'll request Dr. Dinesh Talwar to take up the next topic, which is ICG indications and interpretation. ICG is not available that widely as fundus fluorescein angiography, but still, especially for the choroidal disease, it has become a very important investigation. Dr. Dilwar, please.
Okay, I'm sharing my screen. And okay, can you see the screen?
Yes, Dr. Dilwar. Yeah, just go to slideshow. That's it. Yeah, you're okay. Clear. All set.
Okay, thank you. So far, we've talked about fluorescein angiography, and of course, we don't need to talk about optical coherence tomography. It's there all over the place. Are these two tests adequate for characterization of retinal and choroidal lesions, for diagnosis, for treatment, for follow-up, and for prognostication? Let's see. With fluorescein angiography, the biggest limitation is you can't view through blood. Also, very poor visualization through choroidal pathology, very poor delineation of an occult CNVA, and just see a gross leakage, especially RPE detachments. What about OCT? Well, OCT cannot delineate the vessels anyway, normal or abnormal, and it cannot delineate flow. It cannot delineate areas without perfusion. It cannot delineate any leaking areas. So what does ICG do, which these two can't? Well, the characteristics of ICG are that absorbs light in 790 to 805 nanometer, and the emission spectrum is from 770 to 880 with a peak at 835 nanometer. The advantage is it can give you an enhanced imaging of the choroidal vasculature, choroidal neovascularization, pigment epithelium detachment. And why is that? Because most of this dye is protein bound. And 80% of the ICG molecules actually bind to globulins. Previously, it was thought to be albumin. And so very little dye escapes from the fenestrated choroidal vasculature. Now, because of this, and because of this, the wavelength, the visualization of dye through overlying melanin and xanthophyll is present, is possible. And is also possible through serosanguinous fluid, a shallow hemorrhage, or some pigment or X-ray, though not completely. So just like for fluorescein angiography, you talk of hypofluorescence and hyperfluorescence. We've used the term hyposinescence and hypersinescence for ICG, but there is a controversy on this also. So people say you should call it as hypofluorescence due to ICG, though probably semantically the best term would be hyposinescence and hypersinescence. Hyposinescence is when there is a relative block of the fluorescence, either by pigment, blood, serous, fluid, exudate, or because of impaired perfusion, or because of a blocked blood flow. So all these things will cause hypersinescence. Hypersinescence, why you get hypersinescence? When there is a lack of overlying tissue, that's called RPE dropouts or lacquer cracks, you can have, so this is important to remember. People think that there's no such thing as a window defect as far as ICG is concerned. That's not true. Also, leakage from retinal pigment, retinal and choroidal vessels with staining of the surrounding tissue, or leakage from an abnormal tissue or abnormal vessel, like a hot spot or a plaque that happens, CNVM or polyps. So just to show you what does hyposinescence look like. On one side, you have the fluorescein angiogram, and below you have infrared photograph. I couldn't get a color photograph of this patient, just to show you the large amount of subretinal bleed. And you can see through this subretinal bleed also, you can see the underlying hyposinescence, and you can see this hypersinescence area here, and you can have a reasonably good picture of the underlying vasculature also, choroidal vasculature also. What about the other eye? The other eye, you can see there's an RP detachment on the FA. And if you see the ICG, you can see the area of the RP detachment again shows an hyposinescence. And within this, you can see over here, there is a plaque-like kind of lesion, which is hypersinescent. Now, what all do we use ICG for? Well, most often nowadays it's being used for PCV, also for documenting and occult CNVMs. Sometimes you can pick up the CNV. It's also not now, but previously used to be used to identify feeder vessels for a neovascular AMD. It's good for diagnosis of choroidal tumors. Also being used for study of chronic central serous chorioretinopathy. And of course, Vaishali's favorite topic of posterior uveitis. Virtually all the conditions you can name, ICG would have a role there. So if it's such a great investigation, why didn't it become popular? The fact is it didn't become popular because of the lack of technology, which was sufficiently sensitive to capture good quality images, and the exorbitant cost of technology when it actually became available. You see, the fundus-based cameras give you this kind of image. The SNO-based cameras give you this kind of image on with such a clear details of the choroidal vasculature. So obviously, if you these are very expensive, and without them, you don't feel very good about doing an ICG. Now, in ARMD, you need it basically for occult CNVMs, and also in that form of occult CNVM, the PCV, which is now becoming very popular, very commonly diagnosed. So look at this. This was a fibrovascular PED, and you could see the PED on the OCT. And when you do the ICG, this is a combined ICG OCT and FA, you can see that in the late phase, there's a plaque formed. Incidentally, it happened in the late phase because the leakage actually starts happening only around the CNVA in the late phase. And that's when the contrast becomes better. Now, ICG may help you to detect a well-defined CNVM in half the patients of occult CNV. And in some of them, it may turn out to be a subfoveal location, which may be amenable to laser. So it's worth doing an ICG for those patients. The second important place is PCV, which today constitutes 20 to 40% of cases of occult CNVM. And let's see here how it works. See, clinically, you can make a diagnosis based on the orange reddish nodules in the fundus, the extensive hemorrhage or exudation. But these are only, they only give you an idea. What do you see on ICG? You can actually see the clusters or single polyps, which are there. They may be pulsatile. So if you do an ICG as a video ICG, in addition to that, you may even be able to see the branching vascular network, which is another characteristic of PCV. Now let's have a look over here. This was a patient with a lot of exudation. The FA only shows a late leakage from an unknown source. The OCT is quite characteristic. This kind of OCT with a peak PED, shallow undulating RPEDs with a double layer sign over here. These are all signs of a PCV. And what do you see over here? Now, when you do the ICG, you can see the branching. You can see the branching vascular network, and you can see one or two small polyps. But when you go to the late phase here, you see there is a plaque lesion here. So you have both the things. You have a diagnosis of PCV, and this has now seems to have gone to the stage of a CNVM formation also, and that's confirmed by an OCT angio. Now, this is another patient where you can see the polyps in the early phases. Incidentally, the polyps are seen within the first 6 minutes. And then you can see they stand out in the late phase. In the second case, no other lesion is there. But ICG can also be used to assess quiescence of a polyp. Has it become inactivated? Has it become resolved? So, which you cannot get in any other way. So now look over here. First of all, you can actually characterize the OCT changes with the IC changes. That where you see the polyp on ICG, do you see it also on the OCT? And you can see, this is just to show you that correlation. And then now you look at this. The initial lesion showed these many polyps on the ICG. In the second one, one of these polyps has resolved, two are still there. So there is partial resolution. And if you follow this up, by 2017, from 15 to 17, polyps had got inactivated, no longer any fluid on the OCT. But regression was only of one of the polyps. You see, this one has the first I don't know if you can see my pointer. This polyp is no longer there in this second one, 2017. But by 2018, all of them had regressed. Now, in chronic CSR, on the other hand, what you get, if you see the fluorescein angiography, also shows you a sick RPE and these multiple areas of leak. You can see this kind of hyperfluorescence in the initial phase before the angiogram was started. And only subretinal fluid with a little bit of RPE changes. And then what do you see when you, and you see that this over a period of time. Now, when you do the ICG, in the early phase, you see a early hyposinusitis. This is due to late filling. Then you start seeing tortuosity of these vessels over here. You see this? The tortuosity of the vessels in that area and dilatation. And then finally, you have skinning of the lesion, which you see over here. Now, this is to show you there are window defects sometimes, which are corresponding to the areas which have changes on fluorescein angiography. It's not that the sick RPE can cause window defects in the ICG also. So this is another patient where you can see these. And the important thing is, you can have CSR, sometimes the ICG may show a plaque has developed, a CNVM has developed also. So you can find that also on an ICG. The last important thing I want to discuss, just two slides. You see these of a choroidal hemangioma. This patient had filling which increased. You can see it starts in the early phase, increases further, and then washes out. This is characteristic of a choroidal hemangioma as opposed to a granuloma. And you can see this only had presented before. This is another patient with the same. And here it looked like a large granuloma, but actually this mound combined with this picture, which shows early filling, and then that early filling becomes intense and then it washes out. Whereas on the fluorescein angiography, it just becomes more and more intense. So you can differentiate a choroidal hemangioma from a granuloma. So ladies and gentlemen, ICG improves our diagnostic capabilities in choroidal and retinal disease. Now it's been refurbished and it can help in management of polyparietal choroidal vasculopathy, in chronic serous retinopathy, and in many inflammatory choroidal diseases. So if we use this judiciously along with fluorescein angiography and OCT, we can significantly improve our diagnostic capabilities and understanding of the pathophysiology of these conditions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. This is a very elaborate talk on ICG and with the ultra wide field angiography options coming in. I think the availability of ICG is also increased. So I'll request Dr. Shishir to for the next talk on ultra wide field angiography, the options and the interpretations. Dr. Shishir Narayan from Shirov Eye Center.
Hi, is my screen visible?
Not yet, sir.
Now it is visible, yes.
Thank you, Dinesh, for having Dinesh Garg for having me for the symposium, and a happy birthday again to Dr. Talwar. So I'll be talking on the options and advantages of ultra wide field imaging. Of course, no financial interests here. So there was an international wide field imaging study group comprising of 11 retina specialists who evaluated the set of 7 images, and they were limited to images, and they tried to define these words, these terms, and wide field angiography would be limited to images that could take all the 4 vortex ampullae in one shot, while the ultra wide field image was one which had the image of all the 4 quadrants beyond the vortex ampullae. The posterior pole was the area of about 50 degrees, while the mid periphery was the region between the posterior edge of the arcade up to the vortex ampullae. And a pan-retinal image would be an aura to aura image. Would be an aura to aura image as seen here by these authors. So we have this in from this article, a 20 degree field, a 30, a 50, and then these seven fields, which give you about 75 degree, and then the red cam, which gives you about 130 degrees in one shot, and then the clarus and spectralis, which give about 150. So this is wide field, and then the optos, which is giving you a truly 200 degree ultra-wide field image. And this has been recently, you know, the various options have been discussed in a recent article this year in IGO as well. So this is what would be a 30 degree or a 50 degree field. And what is important is that when you have an ultra-wide field photograph, you're actually getting to know what is happening in the mid-periphery, in the periphery, and at the center. So you have got CNP areas over here, and you've got non-perfusion, and there is macular edema over here, and there is retinal vasculitis. So you can put two and two together in just one image, and you can have all the images, all the features in one shot itself. So this was a conventional angiogram, and it missed a small NVE, which was picked up on the ultra-wide field, and quickly you can confirm it by the conventional angiogram. So now we know that diabetes is not just mid-peripheral disease. There is peripheral ischemia as well, as Sangeet had shown earlier in one of the his slides. And you can have an NVE beginning outside the mid-periphery or juncture of the mid-periphery and the far periphery. So traditional photograph would give you 30 degree and a 7. This is why we use the 7 fields, because the NVEs are located in this 7 field. But what actually is happening is the CNP areas are located outside that. So the effect is located inside, but the cause is outside. So that is why it is important to get your ultra-wide field image to know exactly where the ischemia is. And you can actually miss those very early NVEs, even in diabetic disease. In vascular block, there is the concept of the ischemic index. We know that we used to talk about disc areas when we were talking about development of NVD in CRVO. But what you actually do is to quantify it. You can actually calculate by the pixels of non-perfusion and the total area of pixel, and you have the ischemic index, and you know there is a 30% ischemic index. And what is important is that it shows that when there is non-perfusion in the periphery, it causes both neovascularization as well as the macular edema. And that is what Sangeet had earlier said, the concept of treating the peripheral with peripheral photocoagulation in cases of vascular occlusions and diabetic retinopathy when there is a resistant macular edema in these cases. So here is a CRVO, or rather I would say venous stasis, and you have these CNP areas over here, and the late frame is actually showing you the development of macular edema and disc edema. So whether this is related or not can actually be seen after you do the laser treatment to these areas. And here is a hemi-CRVO, and you can see the large confluent areas that require immediate treatment to prevent neovascularization. And the ischemic index here would be as high as 70 or 80% in these cases. So the ischemic index has been really helpful. And when the ischemic index is over 45%, then the risk of neovascularization increases considerably. And when it is below 6%, then the risk of neovascularization is almost nil. So this is a patient who has got neovascularization of the iris. And you do a conventional angiography, you see a little bit of a leak here. Yes, there is some neovascularization of the disc, but where is the ischemia? And when you do the ultra-wide field, even through those small pupils with neovascularization of the iris, you can actually delineate large areas of peripheral non-perfusion. And therefore, a targeted laser treatment would help in regressing the neovascularization of the iris. This is retinal vasculitis. So in retinal vasculitis, you get two things from the fluorescein angiography. If you see the staining of the walls, you know that you're dealing with an active disease. And if there is a peripheral CNP areas, then you are getting a neovascularization. So this patient has actually developed a new small neovascularization while the disease is coming under control. And we've actually done exactly laser only to that area which is showing on the ultra-wide field. And you can see that the neovascularization has regressed. And we have saved the peripheral field by not doing a pan-retinal photocoagulation, but treating completely the CNP areas that you see in retinal vasculitis. We have been talking about safety of fluorescein dye. And I have done a very large number of angiograms. I've come to the conclusion that if you decrease the dose of the dye, definitely the side effects come down. So when I have a patient, when our machines are improving, we are SLO based, why should we give the standard 3 ml? I've come down to giving 1 ml or 1.5 ml. And you can see that you get an equally good image, in fact, better image, because the leakage of dye is lesser. So, and your machines are so much better. So you are going towards a low dose angiography when you have got the more sensitive systems. And this is an SLE with kidney disease, and you got the neovascularization here, which has been beautifully seen here. And this is a case of sickle cell from the major review in survey, and you can see the neovascularization elegantly in this patient with sickle cell disease. So ultra-wide field, is it really useful? Is it indispensable? And what are the special situations? So myself and Darius, our group, we were the first to do angiography through an air bubble. And you can actually see that the conventional angiogram shows reflectance. And you actually don't get anything in the air bubble. But when you do it through the ultra-wide field, because it's an SLO-based system, and the source of the laser is a pseudo source within the eye, you can actually take the image through the gas bubble. So we were able to, this is a 2016 publication of angiogram in a patient who had diabetic, who had surgery for proliferative diabetic retinopathy, and we could see the retinal status. These are very small pupils. You don't know what is really happening, but when you do the angiogram, you can see that it still requires laser augmentation. Far peripheral lesions, like the angiomas Prashant had shown beautifully, can be delineated very beautifully by a ultra-wide field. This is an inappropriate laser because it's an inappropriate angiogram. And you can see that the neovascularization is persisting in the periphery. And this is an indication for a repeated angiography. So this is called in check FFA. You have done the pan-retinal photocoagulation, and then you look for any hidden neovascularization, which you can see here. So pediatric cases, of course, there'll be a talk later, but you can see that this girl has got an abnormality here, and the fellow eye has got paving stone degeneration, and this is probably a congenital fibrovascular proliferation in the periphery. And children are very happy with angiography because they don't have the flash, and you can actually do angiogram very easily in these children. You can see the picture, you can see that there's retinoblastoma, and you can put two and two together with a wide field image that there is a seedling that is happening, and you can have a timeline on the lesions as you have an ultra wide field images, and it was proven here. So you can do FFA even in ROP, and this is again another ROP which we published in 2016 in the Indian Journal of Pediatrics, where we have shown this is a montage image. So in a child with a flying baby position, you can't really get the images so beautifully. So you can put two and two and get an image very beautifully there. So I would conclude by saying that it's a comprehensive, elegant technique, and special situations would be non-dilating pupil, missed lesions are less, and it gives you a more accurate angiographically guided treatment, and it is indispensable in pediatric imaging. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Shishir. I think we are a bit behind schedule, so we'll just continue with our talks. I'll now invite Dr. Vishali for the dye-less fluorescein angiography, that is the OCTA or OCT angiography.
Yes. Am I visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Dr. Dinesh, for this wonderful instruction course, which we are all learning a lot. So OCT angio, I don't think I have to explain the basics because we have all gone over it so many times, but it's just that non-invasive, no dye, and instead of seeing all the plexus merging into one another, as we see on fluorescein, here we see each plexus of retina, that is superficial, intermediate, and deep capillary plexus separately. So that helps us in better understanding. So how does it look like? This is what we look at, the superficial plexus. This is how the deep plexus look. This is the outer retina, which normally doesn't have blood flow. And if you want to study the choroid, you go to the choriocapillaries. The key is that you have to put these lines in the area where you are segmenting it. And that is very important because whenever there is a pathology and your segmentation lines are not appropriate, you will not get a good information from each of these plexus. So Dr. Dinesh gave me a topic where we are currently applying angio-OCT. So I will start with the common disease first, which is diabetic retinopathy that we all see. So in diabetic retinopathy, as was mentioned by Prashant and Sangeet also, that macular perfusion is one of the key factors. And it's very useful in picking up the non-perfused macula to evaluate the FAS, and it can also visualize the majority, but not all the microaneurysms. So if you're planning to do a focal laser to the leaking microaneurysms, I would still go for fluorescein, especially if it is a repeat laser. But OCT angio can definitely detect other abnormalities, which may not be seen on fluorescein, and we will go over them. Now, this is an example of FAS. This is the superficial plexus. Like we are used to of calling FAS ischemic one when we see the irregularity, when we see the increase in the size. But if you do OCT angio, early changes are increase in the intercapillary distance in the superficial as well as the deep plexus would be the earliest sign that this is the patient who's going to develop or in the process of developing macular ischemia. Dr. Prashant said that he showed a case of CRVO where he had to repeat fluorescein angiography to see NVD, but probably you can see these NVDs very nice clinically, of course. And if you feel like documenting, angio-OCT again shows you very well these new vascularization because they do not leak. So you will be able to document them very well and follow them up for regression. Many times you may be confused, especially in vascular occlusion, whether what you are seeing on the optic nerve head is a collateral or an NVD. And conventionally, we have been taught that you do fluorescein, collaterals will not leak, NVD will leak. But actually, you can differentiate the two on angio-OCT also. NVD is raised, and you will see in the vitreous frame, whereas collaterals you will see in the retinochoroidal phase. NVD can be seen in low resolution also, but for collaterals, you need really high resolution 3x3. Most important use of angio-OCT is in the development, characterization, follow-up of choroidal new vascular membranes. So you may be able to identify type 1 membranes, which are just hidden behind the irregular RPE detachment, or a small type 2 membrane, which might be hiding somewhere behind the shell. So I'll show you an example of this case. Like we see the patient, we do the fluorescein, and fluorescein in the late phase shows hyperfluorescence, indicative there is a membrane. But you can see it's very well just in the outer and not doing an NGO CT, thus avoiding the need for any dye injection. Now, these are the patients, especially the old patients, and you are following them up. So you cannot be time and again repeating the fluorescein whenever in doubt. OCT, of course, is a very great tool, but OCT shows you the fluid. So if you really closely want to monitor, these can be monitored just on NGOCT, and you can look for the pruning and persistence of the vasculature. Pruning is a good sign. It means the new vessels are responding, and you can actually start injecting when the size of the new vessels increases, even if there is no fluid on OCT. This is just to show another case, and this is where it is being very commonly used, patients of chronic CSE. So in some of these patients of chronic CSE, we were kind of injecting Lucentis or whatever anti-VEGF without even realizing why we were injecting. But now with the advent of OCTHU, we have started identifying these small new vessels which are hidden and developing, lurking behind, I would say, underneath the chronic CSE, and that makes giving anti-VEGF so much sense in CSE. Because earlier it used not to make sense to me why treat CSE with anti-VEGF, but post-NGOCT definitely, if I see these kind of membranes, I would treat. And you can see the patient of CSE responding, even the fluid is disappearing because this component had come from small vessels, and you can see the vessels reducing in size. Wide field OCT montage is extremely useful to pick up the areas of ischemia, even if you may not be able to see new vessels very clearly. So this is an example of a patient, occlusive vasculitis. The fluorescein, of course, is still beautiful, showing the vessels which are leaking. But if you are doing NGO-OCT, the wild field, you can still delineate these areas of capillary non-perfusion and the network of abnormal vessels which can be treated. And this is the same post-treatment. You can see the laser scars, and you can see the area of capillary non-perfusion before and after the treatment. Leakage is a problem, and that is where you should not be relying on NGO-OCT. So if you are actually looking for the peripheral vascular leak, the conventional NGO-OCTs that we have, you can see here, they do not, like the left eye is showing the leakage, but macular edema is there, which you can pick up on OCT, and OCT is an integral part of NGO-OCT. So you have to always see NGO-OCT along with OCT. But if you want to pick up these area of leakage, you are going to definitely miss them on NGO-OCT. However, there are now new methodologies, like you can color code them. For example, red would mean these are the vessels which are having vasculitis, but these are kind of not yet commercially available. So we are going to reach a stage where we will be able to pick up the leakage on NGO-OCT. Wild field is very effective in picking up these small granulomas, and this is the ICG that I am showing, but see the superimposition of NGO-OCT. So to an extent, this NGO-OCT can pick up,
and you can monitor them.
Oh, sorry, this is the recorded one. I'm sorry.
The take-home message that I would like to get, that OCT NGO is progressively reaching a primary position in the precise assessment of uveal inflammation. The potential development has not been completely explored yet, but fluorescein and ICG will be able to get them replaced, but their role actually has to be, we have to define their role very correctly. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
You're a pioneer in this field and your great research work. We will keep following. This is an evolving investigation, and it will help a lot of us in future. So now I invite Dr. Diksha for a special pediatric fluorescent angiography topic. And this is the last topic of our session, and I hope we'll be able to finish it in time. Dr. Diksha, please.
Yes, at the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Dinesh for the opportunity, and I am overwhelmed to be a part of this esteemed panel. So I'll just share my slides. Are my slides visible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
And is my voice clear?
Sure.
Thank you.
Please go ahead.
Okay, so my topic is pediatric fluorescein angiography, indications and interpretation. Disease pathologies often involve the retinal vasculature in children, and examination of the retina, especially the peripheral, is difficult and challenging, as we all know. The bright light of the indirect ophthalmoscope and scleral depression can be really intimidating for children. We know that imaging allows objective monitoring of disease pathology. So in this talk, I'll just give you an overview of platforms available for performing FFA in children, what are the doses commonly used, and just few examples of common indications for performing a fluorescein angiography. With the advent of the wide field and handheld imaging systems, really the imaging in very small and small children has undergone a paradigm shift. So this table just shows you the different platforms which are available for wide field and imaging of the children. Most of them are contact handheld. However, the Optos and the Spectralis and are the non-contact ones. The smartphone imaging can also be used, though the field of view is very variable in this. So these are the platforms where fluorescein angiography is available. We have the RedCam 3 and the Phoenix Icon, which are the handheld devices for use in very small preterm children. And then we have the Optos. And recently there is a device which is the Spectralis Flex, which has come with a C arm. Because all the other devices are actually for children really at this time, multimodality, wherein we have an integrated camera, fluorescein, OCT, fluorescein, fundus autofluorescence is not widely available for very small children, preterms and infants. So the Spectralis Flex is one such device which has come. However, obviously the cost is tremendous. So as far as the positioning of children is concerned, the preterm infants and those who are less than 1 year of age, you can do them in supine position, in topical anesthesia or general anesthesia. The flying baby position is also known for, especially for imaging on the wide field, the Optos. And then children can be made to stand and the machine can be adjusted. The height of the machine can be adjusted, or a height adjustable chair can be used to perform the imaging. Now, the general principles are similar to what is used in adults. For children, we just need to actually counsel the parents. Sometimes they get scared with the insertion of the eye speculum, the contact devices. So you need to explain to them that there may be contact device used, the eyelid and speculums may be inserted and IV access, and that should be cleared. For preterm infants, a nurse or pediatrician or an anesthetic should ideally be available for monitoring. As far as the dose is concerned, both intravenous and oral doses have been reported for performing a fluorescein angiography in children. The doses for most commonly the 20% fluorescein concentration is used at a dose of 0.07 ml per kg, and it can range from to 0.0375 ml per kg for a 20% solution. For the oral, you have to ask the patient to drink the juice rapidly, because otherwise it will cause staining of the teeth. And typically, compared to the intravenous phases of the angiogram, the oral phases will take they'll be delayed, and the choroidal flush may just begin around 2 to 5 minutes, and other phases may be proportionately delayed. So I'll just go through some of the common indications. The first indication is retinopathy of prematurity. The vast majority of ROP diagnosis still remains clinical. However, the role of FFA is increasing with atypical presentations and the use of anti-VEGF therapy. So typically, where would it be indicated? It would be indicated in a zone 1 disease, where we want to see the status of the macular perfusion, which we can see down below, that there is a shunt is there, and you don't see that, you see that the vascularization is limited to zone very posterior, zone 1, and even the macula is not perfused. So here a treatment decision can be based on the guidance of the fluorescein angiogram. If the macula is not perfused, anti-VEGF therapy would be preferred over laser. And this is the second scenario, wherein we can see that there is a posterior zone 2 avascularity. There is some hemorrhages there, but the posterior vasculature is not showing frank plus disease, or it is not that significant. You're not sure whether you are dealing with hemorrhages or this is a new vascularization. So herein angiography comes in help. It clearly delineates the extent of vascularity. It shows what is happening at the vascular-avascular junction, the flat new vascularization, and it confirms that actually you are dealing with a new vascularization and not a hemorrhage. And then it helps to guide the laser treatment, and you can guide it accordingly. Then the third indication would be with anti-VEGF therapy. Now, this is a case of a zone 1 aggressive posterior ROP treated with anti-VEGF therapy. 5 weeks after presentation, we see that the vasculature has developed. The zone 1, it is better as compared to the presentation. However, the periphery still remains vascular. Now, as the child grows, now this baby is 9 months old, still coming with you for follow-up. Now, we don't know, and it becomes increasingly difficult to examine the periphery. We don't know whether the peripheral retina still has some lurking avascularity, peripheral new vascularization. And therein, the fluorescein angiography helps because it clearly tells you what is the limit of the vascularity, are there any new vessels present, and if they are present, then you take a decision to treat. So it helps to actually guide follow-ups, because you can at least terminate the follow-ups. Otherwise, with anti-VEGF therapy, late recurrences are known, and we don't really know when, how long to follow up. The second would be familial exudative vitreoretinopathy, a very, very important indication. We know that it is characterized by avascular retina in the periphery, but children may not report symptoms until advanced stages of disease. Often one eye has really progressed to a retinal detachment, and they come with that eye when we have to actually look at the other eye. So progressive new vascularization and complicated retinal detachments can occur. Fluorescein angiography helps in actually characterizing the disease. So this is one patient, a 9-year-old, who's come with complaints of decreased vision in the left eye. And as you can see, that we can see that the typical findings of FEVR, we have a thick epiretinal membrane, there is dragging of the disc, the arcades are narrow, we see peripheral exudation, new vascularization in the left eye. We know that this is FEVR. But what the right eye, we see the avascularity, but it is the fluorescein angiography which helps to detect these new vascularization, and then treatment can be guided accordingly. FFA is also helpful in staging cases of FEVR for follow-up also, and even after surgery. Then Coats disease and Leber's miliary aneurysms, which are actually a spectrum of the same pathology. Coats disease, sometimes the fluorescein angiography helps in diagnosis because we see the typical retinal telangiectasias. It helps to detect new vascularization, which may be responsible for the recurrent vitreous hemorrhages, because if it is there, then that can be treated. And sometimes it is confused with other pathologies which have an exudative component. And herein, the fluorescein angiography helps us to make a diagnosis. Pediatric uveitis is another important group where FFA may help us. So there is a whole lot of uveitic entities such as intermediate uveitis, vasculitis, VKH, neuroretinitis, sickle cell retinopathy, and IRWAN, which may affect children. A fluorescein angiography helps to document activity, documents the capillary dropout, new vascularizations, macular edemas, and especially important, the choroidal new vascular membranes. So here is one child who's an 11-year-old. He presents with blurring of vision. Vision is good, 6-9. He has some few cells in the anterior chamber and 1+ vitreous cells. Few snowballs which are seen inferiorly. He does not have any macular edema. The disc looks hyperemic, and that is about it. But this angiography shows us much more than what we can clinically see. So there is bilateral diffuse involvement of the retinal vessels. It shows what type of vessels are involved, that these are small capillaries which are affected. Any peripheral neovascularization is detected as is seen here. So then accordingly, tailored investigations can be done, and then therapy can be also tailored according to the diagnosis. This is another very important entity. This is an 8-year-old who presents with decreased vision in the right eye since 1.5 years. He's been referred as a proliferative retinopathy. He's counting fingers in the right eye and 6-9 in the left eye. So there is a vitreous hemorrhage and some fibrovascular proliferation, which we can delineate. But it is the left eye which starts telling us something is wrong. We see disc neovascularization, peripheral avascularity, and the fluorescein angiography confirms the diagnosis that apart from the optic disc vascularization, the typical feature is these arteriolar knots, which you are seeing, and the severe 360 degrees capillary dropout. The presence of these arteriolar knots is diagnostic of IRVAN, and a fluorescein angiography helped in making the diagnosis in this case. Then there are other entities such as Stargardt's disease, where you can see the dark or silent choroid. Choroidal neovascular membranes in BEST and other vitelliform dystrophies can be picked up with fluorescein angiography. Intraocular tumors has been discussed before, so I will skip them. So this is just a cavernous hemangioma, which was masquerading as a pre-retinal hemorrhage, and the angiography helped in the diagnosis.
Ma'am, I request you kindly conclude the session.
It's my concluding slide, that the wide field angiography allows imaging of a larger field in a small time, and that is a boon for children. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Diksha. And with your very elaborate talk, we conclude this session. And I thank all the speakers, Dr. Vishali, Dr. Shishi, Dr. Diksha, and Dr. Sangeet, and Dr. Dinesh Talwar, and Prashant have already left. So thanks, everybody, for sparing your time. And we hand it over to the next session.
I will take it over from you, sir. Thank you so much, Dr. Dinesh, for leading the session throughout. You've been fantastic. Thank you.